you all for coming. My name is Phil Johnson. I'm the president of the Amherst Alumni Association of New York, and we're really grateful to have you all here tonight. Special thanks, obviously, to Paul for volunteering his time, for Joshua, who really is, he's on the board with me as well. He is the driving force behind this event. So thank you for organizing. Just if you have any other ideas for events you'd like to have, or speakers who you know who are alums from your class who maybe want to give a little talk, you can always email them to me as recommendations. And we're always looking for other ideas for alumni who might have interesting things to offer to the alumni community in the city. So with that, I have the pleasure of introducing Jeffrey Wright, 87, who will do a more formal introduction.
Okay. Great to be here. I'm here to introduce Paul, but I'm an actor, so I'm going to start off talking about myself. Because I'm an actor. So there I was. There I was in Montrose, Colorado, coming back home from a ski trip out there with my kids. In the airport there, I saw a gentleman, saw a brother there, in a wheelchair, all decorated, crippled amputee. And I walked over to him, he recognized me, and he struck up a conversation. He talked about his experiences at Walter Reed. He talked about those in my profession who had come by and spent time with me. He listed a number of very fine conservative white guys, and I thought that was great work that they undertook to use their time to try to provide some comfort to someone such as himself. But I asked myself, well, you know, what am I doing with my time? I could, I should be there as well. I had been working with a group that uses classics, Greek classics, Sophocles, Euripides, and the like, as conversations, or conversation platforms around PTSD these explorations of war that the Greeks undertook, yes, discussed the victories and the histories of these wars, but also discussed the consequences. And so I was on the 15th anniversary of 9/11. I was down in D.C. Performing in with this group called the Theater of War, and I happened to have the opportunity to talk to the Department of Defense and ask if I could get more closely involved with some veterans work, and that led me to an opportunity to work with some veterans and active service members suffering from PTSD at Walter Reed and Fort Belvoir. We ended up putting on a stage reading that one of them had asked. The possibility of, they were part of an arts therapy, the written word arts therapy. So I worked with them over the course of a few months, the end of 2016, just before the inauguration, managed to get a theater in D.C. and put on a stage event. About 500 people showed up. It was one of the most extraordinarily powerful experiences I've had in the theater, and I've had a couple of those. But the exercise of working with them led me to a couple of observations that Paul can definitely talk about in more detail, more insight. War is talked about as by some as act of kinetic military action, and the purpose of our military is to defend us, but also to deliver that kinetic energy. And the question becomes, well, what if you're no longer capable of contributing to that energy, or you've done your service, what then? And it occurred to me that these folks who were honoring of their service, were committed to it, were respectful of it, but no longer capable of serving that way. We're no longer, on a fundamental basis, no longer of value. They were no longer of service. to the means of delivering that, that energy. And so what then? And it was almost as though baked into the idea of the military was that once you can no longer contribute, then you're no longer considered in need of our care. You're no longer useful. And so it seemed to me that fundamental to the military perhaps is this idea. Maybe it's wrong, maybe it's right, maybe I'm wrong, maybe not. But going back to the Greeks and who embrace through theater the totality of war, it does fall on us as civilians and as members of larger society to embrace these veterans, to embrace these folks who have stood up in harm's way on our behalf, not only for their sake, but also for our own, for a greater appreciation of the consequences of sending folks into these positions. And so, who out there among us does that? So, enter Paul Rykov. Paul, to read your list of achievements is to undertake an exercise in exploring one's own inadequacies. You started off at Wall Street after you left Amherst, but also joined the New York National Guard. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
And 4 days before 9/11, left Wall Street, and then. On 9/11, took another calling and was deployed to Iraq shortly thereafter, infantry, if I'm not mistaken, and served with distinction. And I'm told that no members of your platoon or every member of your platoon came home. Is that right? Which speaks to this idea of caretaking and speaks to one of the core values of military service is looking after one another. So you continue that. Now, even though you no longer serve actively, and you serve with distinction, you're now a member of the Council of Foreign Relations. Through your work, with IAVA, you have maybe 300,000 veterans, I think, associated with the group. Touched 800,000 in total through your work. And through the small grassroots organization that has become the leading veterans rights advocacy group for folks who served in Iraq and Afghanistan, it's the Iraq Afghanistan Veterans Association, and as well you did a film with Matt Damon. Acted in a movie. That's a slippery slope. You were named in 2009 among the most powerfully by GQ magazine, most powerfully dressed folks in Washington D.C. I think it was actually just the most powerful people in D.C., which as well is a slippery slope. You received a doctorate of humane letters from Amherst College. With that, I'll introduce Dr. Paul Rykov.
All right.